Everybody, thanks for once again attending this afternoon. I think what we've been able to listen to is not only very insightful, but I think this is some great insight into the true future of mobile communication as it stands today and hopefully in the future. So I thank our guests for being with us today once again. What I'd like to do to sort of kick off the panel debate is just one quick question I have to the audience that I'm going to then relay over to our guests and try and get a good answer. Could I see a show of hands of anyone in the room, and don't be shy, a show of hands of any in the room who hasn't heard of Instagram? Instagram, everybody, you've heard of it. So I say Instagram, you think Facebook, but above all, you think $1 billion. Correct? All right. So my question to the panel here is basically not how on earth or, you know, how can I cash in on this and also make $1 billion with a simple app. But when you get down to it, seriously, when you think about it, Instagram, 13 employees, bunch of servers, no revenue. What is it that makes Instagram so valuable to a company like Facebook? Why would they invest so much money into such an app? And where's the future with that? Where do you think Facebook will try and or how could they possibly monetize to be able to match that price tag? Over any of you?
I think if we look at the Facebook business model and the activities in the consumer journey, there are two elements which have been really critical in the time spent by people using the service. One is games, and we know how interdependent is the business model of Facebook with some of the game creators, and how this is becoming quite a sensible subject regarding the valuations. And the second thing is the pictures. Sharing pictures, tagging pictures, etc. So if my second most important asset was about pictures and images, then I don't see really the problem into valuation of a rising star, 13 people or 50. Then 1 billion is a frightening number. But so in Instagram being the, you know, the growing player and really having something which is very smart, very easy to use, and if I have plenty of cash and shares, and I can, you know, secure my long-term positions with pictures, I think it makes sense. Especially if you look at that, the video, which is the third, is for now a lost battle to YouTube and Google. So for a company to build a broadcasting infrastructure at the level of YouTube, it's gonna again require massive investment that nobody's prepared really to do right now. So sounds like a smart move. So I agree. I mean, we should all be thinking about small apps rather than be sitting here. But it's encouraging.
Yeah, that's great. No, I think the mobile aspect, of course, is very important. I think that you're absolutely right, and that sort of cashing in on what could be a very good bet in terms of generating content and revisiting and sort of revamping and innovating the Facebook platform, keeping it alive, keeping its user base tied in, is a very valid point. But when we look at mobile users in general, I mean, we saw some interesting slides both on, I think, in all of your presentations, and we saw.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Can I just say something else, and then
please
I
do.
And
please
then
do.
I shut up.
That's why you're here.
And I think one of the elements here, another learning which is quite interesting from the Instagram team, is that this was not a team of geeks.
They were a team of designers.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, idea people, and yeah, with some skills, but none of them was, a superstar in product or interface design. And I think it for me, it reminds me some of the elements of the previous bubble, but not on the criticism side. On the sides of, we're seeing a lot of, you know, startups, a lot of bloggers, a lot of, you know, new content being brought every day, and some of the people are feeling frustrated, etc. I think really today, what is really amazing is the entry point. Building an app, if you guys have an idea, and I'm not talking here about brands or advertisers. I mean, go for it. Really go for it, because the entry level of building a smart Apple app using some smart offshore production facilities, etc., puts this at the level of any good idea is worth trying. Then be smart to unplug it very quickly, so you don't put in cash and cash into the system. But with few thousands or 10,000 USD, etc., you can have a fully fledged thing. I mean, if you do the design, talking about the development cost here. But I think we should more individually also be in that area. And for this, Instagram should be a super inspirational thing. Then how us companies, and so we've got a full stream called Innovation Work, where we help our talents when they've got an idea to help them to make it go live. And so we've got a specific team fund. This is led by somebody called Doug Warple, who sits in Barcelona, who is an amazing guy. But we should also push our companies to, you know, help those kinds of funds, help those kinds of, you know, ventures, etc. So everybody can try to become Instagram.
Very good point. Thanks for that last note, Reza. But off the back of that, what we're talking about, everybody getting on board, and we're all market. There's a lot of us in this room that are marketeers, and we all have target audiences. I think this question or this point I'm making basically applies to every single one of you sitting on the couches or chairs here. We all have target audiences. Now, to hand in hand with mobile, hand in hand with the advertising, the content we're doing, the devices we're designing, the infrastructure we're putting into place, how is that changing? How are target audiences changing? Are we getting younger, broader? Is it also something that is appealing to more senior target audiences that are fitting into that, you know, 80 billion plus device, handheld device that we're looking at? Are advertisers like P&G looking to appeal to wider target audiences, not just you know, focusing on, as we know with the Golden Household, looking for housewives a certain age, but looking much, much younger than we did before? Are we looking much, much older than we did before? Where do you think we're heading with this?
I think, well, I won't speak specifically for P&G because it's probably any of the work is confidential, but just talking in general, I think the older audience or older consumer or whatever we used to call them, I think that's gotten pushed out. I mean, it's do we really need to speak to someone who is retired different to people who are not retired or have kids at home? Yeah, basically because they might buy more different things. But I think in terms of engagement with technology, it's changed. I mean, we had these questions. I worked with another client a long time ago, a financial services company, not that long ago, relative terms long ago, 5 years ago, where there was the whole discussion about retired consumers and how should we communicate with them. And actually, when we looked into what retirement meant, it's very different from, you know, the days when you just stop doing stuff. And actually, the need to be connected, it actually increases. And that was one of the drivers of people wanting to, entering into social media to stay in touch with kids and grandkids, access to experts or friends and how to do stuff. The research showed in Europe that actually about 60% of, when you asked men about retirement, what are you gonna do? The question was, I'm gonna build a boat. Or I'm gonna, you know, restore a motorbike. And it was really short term. I mean, that's not, you know, your retirement's gonna last hopefully longer than, you know, 5 years in your garage. And so there was a really need to speak to them about how they could engage with services to help them to enjoy that time. But I think in terms of should we try and make things that are slightly different or easier to use, I think that's shifted. You know, my dad's nearly 70, and you know, he's on Facebook. I mean, he's not using Instagram, but and that's in South Africa. He happens to be American, but he lives there. And I think there's different needs about what the information and services are, but I don't think the use of technology. I've got a talking the younger scale, if we want to use a real example, I've got a son who's just over 2 years old, and he can use an iPad self-taught as well as anyone in this room can use. And I mean, that's a credit to obviously Ives, Sir Ives, but it's also just, you know, people are growing into that. That's how they interface with objects, not just tablets, phones, with anything, because it's intuitive. So, you know, I think it's connected as well. If you have a relationship with someone at one age, now with it, you don't have to try and change the way it can evolve with them, also because of the way they can control the relationships themselves. Yeah?
Oh, great, thank you for that. Please.
I would just only add that I think it's also changing by industry. So that I think that one of the most interesting ones to me is actually the farming industry and how much they are into collecting unbelievable amounts of data to be able to optimize to farm. So they're, you know, tracking how much, not only how much rain is coming down, but how well their plants are growing as a result, timing that to harvest and thinking about things like, you know, output and threshold and all these kinds of really interesting technical data. And willing to invest as a result. I mean, so this is the thing, is that these are technologies, again, yeah. This is big infrastructure, this is big services, but it's really interesting how they are fundamentally changing. The farmers are not, you know, the farmer of my grandfather. And the same thing applies with the life science industry, I think. These days, the idea of, getting your patients to comply. This idea actually is very, very valuable. And so they're willing to start thinking about technologies that are, you know, not gimmicky, that don't, and technologies and services that really sort of help you understand, help them understand their job better, and then also help patients, you know, respond. I mean, this has always been the problem, right? So people don't always change in ways that we want to, but if we can get the right information at the right time in ways that are natural and easy, the technology part is, of course, going there.
I love this question because I'm old enough that I remember starting my career. I actually was one of the few guys that liked the B2B. You know, everybody wanted to do consumer marketing, and I thought that's really interesting. But consumers are so fickle; I just don't want to deal. I almost said something else, but I didn't. You know, I really respect. I mean, all the brands, and we're talking, you know, chatting with J&J, P&G. I mean, anybody delivering to consumers is such a difficult job. And all of a sudden, I'm sitting here at you know, this big B2B infrastructure company, and our world has changed so much. Yeah. It's no longer about 400 communication suppliers around the world. Now we sell to broadcasters, we sell to cable companies, we sell to cities, as I talked about earlier. We're looking at health and transport, and there's this big communications infrastructure layer, and underneath it, there's all the charging and the billing and looking at the data that goes into. So we become a touch point for everybody. And so all of a sudden, this nice, you know, cozy kind of B2B, and here's our product, and here's how we sell it, and here's what it does for you. It's not that simple anymore. Yeah. But that's not bad. It's actually really good, and it's exciting. And, you know, I think when we put the programs together, when we start talking about the company, or we talk about the industry, we think a lot about our HR guys, you know, because, okay, if you're in China, Ericsson's it's a pretty good place to work. If you're in the U.S., what did I say? What was the first thing I said? Who's Ericsson? Mm. Right? So we have to think about those guys. We have, and if we don't think about that segment, we're going to miss the next group of MIT guys who start Facebook, or the next group of Harvard guys, or the Instagram. I mean, we're going to miss it. So I think that the summary is a very simple kind of straightforward proposition, even for companies like us, which are very different than consumer brands, have to think about. Yeah. A much broader, complex segmentation, and have to worry about the word of mouth, because it really is powerful. Yeah.
I think for any multinational brand or company, it's, you know, it's so, now that it's so much more global, we also see that it's so much more different in markets, even by life stages. You know, there are similarities, but economically, if you look in Europe, you've got in Spain 50% of between 16 and 24 year olds are unemployed, and so they're in the streets drinking. You know, that's different to markets like in urban China, but also in, you know, Japan, where it's starting to pick up now. It's a different way you need to think about the products you sell and the usage of them and how much can be used by that audience. You know, so you might have a target audience that one day, you know, is your growth audience. The next day, it actually doesn't exist anymore. And brands themselves, multinational brands in some markets, they're seen as, well, that's just a brand which, you know, everyone buys. It's a kind of base level. It's whatever. You go to China, it's a prestigious brand just because it comes from the US or somewhere else. And that goes across all different life stages as well.
And going back to just sort of like the more, if we go to the lower end of the, or lower end, so to speak, but the much younger end, we had a slide where we saw three very, very young kids looking at an iPad. And this is maybe a question more directed at ergonomic design. How can we be thinking more about designing the mobile space for the younger audiences? What do we need to bear in mind for designing for that space for them, not only to understand it and interact with it in the best way, but to develop in the best way? Are there any things that I think us as advertisers could also be understanding how to communicate very well within that space?
I'll give someone else a turn. But I have the real experience on this one right now, and you will, or maybe you already do, but you have another one soon. Is that there's two things going on. One is there is this feeling, and you feel guilty because an iPad or a mobile device or any digital device with your kid is a great way to get something done for a while. As long as you've got some scratch protection on it, it's kind of okay. So you can leave them for 5-10, but there's a guilt association with it as well. So I think there's, but also you think, yeah, they've got to, this is the world we live in and they need to learn this. Well, that's your excuse. But I think some brands are getting it and finding that sort of guilt factor and dealing with it. So Mattel do a great thing with little radio controlled cars with iPhones, so you can integrate a bit of reel because you don't want to lose that great thing of having collect your Matchbox or in the UK or your Hot Wheels cars. I used to have a whole suitcase of them. And Disney do it with their car range where you can race them along on the iPad as well. So I think there's ways that, again, it's the combining the real and the virtual worlds as well. And that's one aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. There's another great example, sort of building on your examples of engaging and interesting products and services. Is Lego has done one that's much more about physical. A mobile app, or it's an app that allows you to sort of randomize a design and then the kids can compete on creating the design quickly as possible and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So it's physical, it's digital, it's learning and that sort of thing. But this is a tricky one. I think the thing is that overall, what devices don't do yet is really considering how the user changes, or meaning more specifically that it's not just there's several users using the same thing. We just right now have profile differences. We're not thinking about how you might actually deliver different kinds of ecosystems of products to support this kind of thing. And maybe we don't need to. I mean, it's funny that every smartphone looks the same, but you know, it's still, I think, when we think about opportunities for designing for these new ways of behaving and these new audiences, we can just start thinking more about this idea that the idea of the ecosystem. You had that great network map that really sort of is the beginning of where we're at. You know, I don't know if that's
anything. Yeah, and I also think it's really interesting of seeing this like playing together thing, which I think we often miss out. It's still like one game and you can maybe look at it together, but you're not really playing it together. I think like the Toka Tea Party, they actually suddenly have three different spaces and really working with it. And looking into like the surface table we have outside here, that even though that's much bigger, but for children an iPad still is good enough, and it has four sides, and you, I think that's a space that's not really taken, that most interact with it like a phone being really small and that you play on your own. So I think that's a space to take, but then of course it's a...
Yeah, it sounds like it's a bit improv'd at the moment, isn't it? It's improv'd, it's working through a fact that probably defensive, because it's... Your example with Lego is, okay, well, Lego makes blocks and we sell little pieces of plastic. That's our business. And actually, there's these other things that are competing with it, the time, competing with time with their kids. And I think that goes back to the Facebook, Instagram. It's competitive. It's a competitor. It's a buy the competitor strategy. People spend more time and they use that. And especially in markets where social and Facebook is only interacted in mobile, that's the way it goes, and let's fight for that time. So if they're interacting on Instagram, it's now Facebook, so we're cool. Yeah.
Okay, I just want to see if there's any questions from the audience. Anybody like to ask anything? Don't be shy.
Sorry. I said bad eyesight. I'm not ignoring you. Where were you?
Hi, my name is Johan, and I'm having a question about when you think the web will be real time. I mean, lots of stuff is push, and you talk a lot about connecting devices, but still there's a user manual user. You need to do something before you can connect. I mean, when do you think there will be a interconnected, connected automatically between devices?
That's an Ericsson question.
I'm so glad there's a demand for that. It means there's more to be done. It's really what we talked about earlier, and I guess I couldn't tell you when, but I can empathize with that, and I feel the same. As I described earlier, I think, well, we're so, technology has progressed in so many ways, but there's still so much to do, and I think what I call the, you know, kind of the operational layer that exists between the communications infrastructure, where you have to connect all of these devices together, and that's a different operating system, Android or iOS or Windows. It's a different hardware provider, HTC, Sony, Apple. There are different connection points for payment systems, any financial institution or company that has become a financial institution, and we are, you know, in some instances it can work really well. I think the best cases are when everything is already integrated, but there is a lot of work to do yet to make sure that experience, as I described earlier, that network society experience would exist the same in the U.S., get on a plane, fly to Sweden, or fly down to Tanzania, and exist the same everywhere. And that's, of course, that's, you know, part of that is something that we work on every day, particularly when it comes to the mobile infrastructure, the how people are charged and billed, but it's a long way to go. I can give one example quickly in thinking about cities. Where are we going to be if car charging, if electric cars become really predominant? And I'm not the right person to answer that question, but we have to look at it. Let's say that in Stockholm it does, and we all have electric cars, and I invite you all to my house for dinner. Well, it's great because I can pay for the food and the wine, and hopefully we drink a lot and have a good time. What if you all want to plug your car in at my house? Now I haven't really thought about who's going to pay for that. But that's, you know, that's a real issue. And so together with Volvo and with Victoria Institute, we've been looking at this. And through the mobile network, through connecting that to the grid through GPS, you actually can identify a person very easy on your phone. And whose car owns this, what location is in, what should they be charging, who gets charged, so that I can all invite you to dinner. And I will be glad to pay for the wine and the food, but you can pay to charge your own car. Because I know some of you are going to show up with no charge in your battery. That's just the way you are. So I think we're thinking about it, and you're right, we're not there yet, and it's going to take some time. And I guess for us, that's a good thing. We like complexity.
Great question. Any other questions?
I'd like to add something to that, actually.
Oh, go for it.
This is actually, I think, a very political question. I'm going to go political on you. Which is, because of the idea that the idea of creating integrated, networked, continuous systems is actually one where you talk about if whether or not it's all owned by one person, and whether that is... The challenge of one integrated system is that it works better when one person owns it, or one company, or one what have you. But then it also then changes the dynamics of innovation and open, and what it means to create things that are sort of interesting. So I think this is actually the real big challenge of the next 25 years or so, because I agree we have to deliver it, but who knows? Just getting excited there.
Anybody else? Okay, Sarah, do you mind if I stretch over here? Hang on.
I have a really simple question, I think, but anyway, we've been kicking it around for some time. We don't really have an answer on it. It's basically mobile apps versus mobile sites, when to do the either or the first one or do both. I understand from a user perspective when it comes to smartphones with the gyro and everything like that, but do we have a clear definition when it's good to do the one or the other, basically?
Yeah, so there is a notion about responsive design, which is trying to get to design device agnostic design, which helps using some some very recommended technologies like HTML5, which would then be parsed to fit any kind of screen, because I think we are now looking at screens. I've got a German car. It has a app system on the GPS, so I can browse if I'm not driving. Some of the traditional, you know, websites, the Googles, the Facebook, etc., or the Twitters, within the GPS of the car, and if it's not device agnostic, it becomes terrible because, of course, it's not a computer behind it. So I think this is the first step. I mean, but very few companies have, you know, invested into building device agnostic designs that will help have a consistent content delivery, not look and feel, because it's like the question for real time. I love real time, but I'm asking why. So which technologies will really benefit from real time? Near time is already great. So again, what is it the design we want or the content? And I think content wise, we absolutely need to move away from specific things and go to responsive design. But this is what we call in our jargon, it's the depth. What is the additional value we're gonna bring to people? And then we go into services. So having, like having Domino's pizzas menu card and delivery hours and phone numbers on the website available on the mobile, I think it's the depth. Having you to have an app that creates your bespoke pizza, see where it's, how you want it cooked, et cetera, this is additional service. So there you move from content that is sitting on existing, you know, content holders, placeholders, moving to services. But of course, all this hopefully is getting, you know, completely convergent. We all have TV sets that have, you know, or some of us have now TV sets that come usually with YouTube at least, and maybe Daily Motion and three other four streaming services. So all those are getting, you know, like connected. And there is no choice. It's next year where we're gonna access more internet through mobile devices, wherever they are, than computers. So yeah, we have to adapt.
Just wanted to check with Glenda in the corner here, see if we have any tweets that we should be putting forward to our panel as well.
We have a question here from Scrap Hacker. Are we seeing a clash of rockstar app designers versus geeks? Is app branding more important than actual service innovation?
Can you repeat that?
Yes, again,
quickly?
Of course. Are we seeing a clash of rockstar designers, like app designers,
yeah,
versus geeks? And is app branding more important than actual service innovation?
Okay. Yeah, interesting. I think the Instagram example, which is a great one, which is taking a sort of jumping on a trend. I mean, everyone was, if you were in Flickr or where you see a lot of photography trends starting, you'd see a lot of people sort of, it started with people processing things in a retro way, and then people were selling Photoshop actions, so you could do it yourself, and it kind of grew out of that. So it's not such a geeky thing, I suppose. If you spend your life on Flickr, you could be considered a geek, but it comes out of that side of it. I think the interesting thing, and I won't use an example right now, but we talked about it, is on the branded app side, is the difference between buying some time with the consumer because you're giving them some entertainment or some sort of tool or you're just on the app store, compared to actually having a service itself. And I guess the real difference is, if you look at some of those examples of the services where they're created by, say, marketing, they've got a brand in them, sometimes that you could actually think, well, actually they would belong better to another brand. And also, if it's the actual brand service, then why not sell it as part of the service? Why is it not, something that also then is part of the sale that's baked in, that maybe you only get if you buy it, rather than it's kind of free to everyone to use, even if you don't have the product? You know, and so sometimes, yeah, it's seen as a media channel. And I think if it's thought about a bit more, if it's baked into the product design at the beginning, like Nike have done, like the Garmin example, I think that's where you really get the added benefit. I mean, an example that we've had done with, we created a service with P&G for Tried and Tested, which is public domain, it's available. Tried and Tested is ratings and reviews of P&G products, but it's evolved through that. And the way the app works there, which is prototyped in France, is not to be able to go in the store and flick through your, you know, okay, what was the, there's a new version of Ariel out, maybe it costs a bit more because it's got stain removal, should I buy it, I always buy the other one, I'm happy with it, I'm gonna browse through and see what people saw, rather a phone has got a camera on, I can scan the barcode and it tells me that actually, not only me, but people like me with two kids, so I'm dealing with the same kind of stains, thinks it's great, I'm actually going to now make a purchase based on some information. And that's something that drives a sale or helps to make a decision at a sale. There are the apps where it's a branding experience, like a game, and it's always been that way. I think it does both.
Do you have any other tweets, Glenn? I saw one earlier on that I like, but go for it if you got one.
I have a question. From Magnus. How does the role change for the agency now that we have to work more with usefulness?
Personally, I'm super happy because I think it's less boring. So I think it's a fantastic opportunity. I think the ad industry or the marketing industry has always been about creating value for our clients and for our brands, and there is nothing wrong in business value. Of course, I fully agree on the emotional side, and this is somewhere I think we've checked the box. But with trends changing, and let's think about something else, which is I think we are in Western Europe at least on a downturn cycle. So is it going to last? Is it dramatic? Is it going to last as dramatic as it is now in few markets? I don't think so. But we are in a downturn cycle. We've got some of our chairman is based in Singapore, and he told me, which is already a sign, chairman of Proximity Worldwide no longer sits in London or New York. He sits in Singapore. And he told me about one of his clients who said, yeah, emerging markets and declining markets. It's not anymore about emerging and mature markets. In emerging markets and declining markets, and I was very, very shocked to know I'm living in a declining market. But the fact is that if this downturn cycle for our continent, for our region, is gonna, you know, be a kind of a stable outlook, and we're gonna be declining for many reasons, I think the usefulness part will even be more critical. We need, as brands, as marketers, to really deliver value. And again, I mean, we talked a bit about P&G, you talked about product design. I mean, these companies, they are number one because their product is superior by design, by the concept until the delivery. Yes, sorry, it washes cleaner and it shaves better. So now, how marketing can support product by offering services that add value to the experience, I think this is a fantastic role for an agency. We'll go into transformations, but this is, again, I'm not worried about the agencies around because I think transformation has been in our DNA. I mean, we've passed from a dominant channel to multiple TV stations, then we moved from when we started to master TV, we went to digital, and then now we are in fragmented digital and device agnostic, and we start technology jargon, etc., for all of us. So I have no worries. I think we are living interesting times, and this is super. This is super. Social media and service-oriented branding is really what makes us wake up at night, but also have a great day.
Yeah. I can comment from the client side as well, and I've been on the agency side for a long time and now sitting in-house, but I agree, and I actually think one of the best things you said earlier was when you talked about the simple idea. you know, the rest of it is there, but bring me the simple idea. I love the idea of a tweetable idea, you know, or one that you can fit in a text message, because that's where we're going to struggle inside, you know, the client is going to struggle. How do you get that creative idea in the middle of your day, your week, your month, where you're delivering on everything you're delivering on? And so the agencies of value, and they're there, even in an economic time that's not good, whether it's in Europe or wherever, when they bring the good idea and tell you how you're going to execute it. And I think, and even to take it a step further, probably still in this economic times, there's a lot of those good ideas left on the floor, unfortunately. So I think it's for you from the agency side to kind of, you know, to make sure you bring the original idea. I've had plenty of agencies, and they only get to do it once, come in with somebody else's idea. That's not going to work, not for us. But bring the original idea and how we're going to do it, how are we going to execute it. And it's of so much value, I can tell you. It was going to make my year much easier, and I'm going to be smiling a lot more when you walk out after giving me the Snickers example was excellent, because it's, when that resonates with me, I'm going to go, there's the idea. That's the next 6 months. That's how we're going to do it.
Well, and I would just add that if we're talking about how does the agency change to deliver on usefulness, I mean, the design industry has gone through this change, I think, just in the last, since the late 80s. I mean, there's been great examples, Dreyfus and others, who were delivering on usefulness before, but the design world had a sort of identity crisis about what they were supposed to be doing. Was it all about styling and that sort of thing? And, you know, it began this journey of what it means, really identifying usefulness, starting with, I think, sort of traditional market research, and then moving into more specifically things that are much more contextual and much more in depth. This is actually, it's really interesting to me that in the early 90s, having a conversation about how you were gonna do, you know, ethnographic or contextual research was like unheard of. You know, it was a special niche companies. And now it's offered by most market research firms, even if they don't do a great job of it. I think it's really an art and science about how to figure out how to change the mindset of your team internally to value the user, the people who are using it, more than the creative. And that's really, I mean, it's still, you know, those companies who do it well, IDEO, you know, Frog, or whatever those are, and they do a great job of that, but ergonomy design.
I think what's as important as that, what we found is, so yeah, it's sort of, instead of making stuff for people, you make it with people, or at least you have them. And we talk about the changing, I think, with agencies. I think that's as true, or is becoming as true, with the agency-client relationship. I think even if it's just the small idea and working with that, is because I think some of these ideas and services and what wraps around a product or a brand become integral to the brand, unless it's just a content sort of channel, it then sometimes or oftentimes touches other parts of the business that aren't normally involved in the marketing function, you know. So if you want to do something that is linked to sales, if you want to include a service or an app or something with a product, do you possibly need to be involved with the printing of that box that the product comes in, or the product design of the shoe? And so I think if an agency starts to take some of that role in the idea, then it needs to start much earlier. I mean, we know in agencies, ideas can come out in, well, we all say it takes a very lot of weeks, but it can happen quite quickly. And that's not the case in, you know, designing shoes or cars or washing detergents or anything else. There's years and years of lead time involved.
I 100% agree with you. That's one of the most interesting things, is this idea that then it's about facilitating this relationship across the board. It's great.
Okay, I think that's all we got time for, guys, unfortunately. Once again, like, thank all of you for coming here today, for making this happen. It's been great having you. But above all, thanks to our panel here. If we could just give them one last round of applause.